talking to executives around the league, you know, a month ago it was like, oh yeah, it'll work out. He'll be back. Then it was like, oh, I think I think it'll work. Now it's like, how are we going to trade for Kawhi?
Exactly.
The league thinks Kawhi is going to be on the market. And to me, the reason this is interesting, beyond what happens in this playoffs, and we'll focus on Spurs. They play tonight and the Cavs play on Wednesday. What happens to Kawhi Leonard is a link to what happens to LeBron. Where Kawhi ends up this season will have a direct impact on where LeBron ends up. Even if they don't play together, it could they are going to be linked in where their futures are going to be.
Okay. So your take, what's going on with them?
You know what? I learned more about the Spurs through this process now than I did about Kawhi. Before, I was all Team Spurs. Then I paused for a second. The reason why I'm so Team Spurs is because I had 20 years of what I thought was this goodwill. And then I started asking myself, well, why are they somewhat getting a pass for treating Kawhi in this fashion? Why are you using this language which makes him seem like an outsider as opposed to an insider by being more inclusive with we? Whereas Kawhi, instead of saying, ask his guys, saying he's not available right now. Those are two different sort of directions to go in with the dialogue. Then I started asking myself, well, is it because with Popovich, for instance, we like him so much, and sometimes he says the thing about social issues that we enjoy hearing from, and so we give him more of a benefit of the doubt because we like Pop. Then I thought about, you know, all the other players, the Tim Duncans, the David Robinsons, potentially good guys. Well, all the good guys play for the Spurs, so if the Spurs don't like Kawhi, Kawhi must be a bad guy. Now I'm realizing that maybe that narrative, wasn't the right narrative to have to begin with.
Some of this player sauce is rubbing off. And that's it. I've been saying that from day one. I've been Team Kawhi. First of all, hey, Popovich, shoes on the other foot. How does that feel? Oh, it's a little tight. Because when players want to sit there and say, I'm going to take care of myself to 100% capacity. All Southern organizations have an issue with this. And I'm looking at them like, look, I'd rather be Kawhi Leonard right now than Isaiah Thomas going forward.
Oh, that's a good example.
And you know what happens when you try to go on that court with one leg saying, I'm going to get right while the cameras are filming me. You're going to lose value. So when coaches can walk around and say, I had a sleepless night, my back hurt, whatever it is, and they get their leave of absence, and we don't say a damn thing, don't you say nothing to Kawhi until that guy wants to come back on the court.
Okay, so we, and Brian, trust me, I heard what you said. You dropped a bit of a nugget on us in a bombshell. I didn't ignore it. So you're saying that, and we're under the impression that they're not going to be together next year, that Kawhi will leave. So you're saying it's directly tied to
the Los Angeles
LeBron.
Lakers should be having meetings right now about what trade-up package they're going to offer the Spurs the day after the Spurs season is over, which could be shortly.
And the Clippers have already had those meetings.
Why?
Because look, people are paying attention to free agency. There's more ways to get players than just free agents. You can trade for them. And I also want to point something else out. As you think about what could happen with Kawhi, LeBron doesn't have to be a free agent this season. People forget that. LeBron has the Chris Paul option in his contract. LeBron can force a trade to somewhere. So a team that even is full right now, you say, well, they don't have cap space. If they could figure out a way to trade for Kawhi, they could force their way. And the reason that Kawhi has power about this is he's only got 1 year left on his contract. He doesn't have 4 years left. So if he goes to the Spurs and says, you're going to trade me, I'm not going to sign an extension there. You can't trade me to Toronto. I'm not going to sign an extension there. You can't trade me to Milwaukee. He's going to say, I want to be traded to this team.
Wait, are you saying Kawhi and LeBron want to play together? I don't understand. Explain that to me.
Well, I'm going to tell you this way. If the Cavs get knocked out before the finals and LeBron has 6 weeks to think about things and 6 weeks to get in touch with Kawhi, things could get a little crazy. But just think about Philadelphia, for example. I can construct you a way that Philadelphia could trade for Kawhi Leonard and sign LeBron James.
Oh, my God.
That possibility
illegal.
Exists.
Illegal. Canceled next season.
But I think the point you have to look at here is what happens to Kawhi, whether he gets moved and goes to a place and LeBron comes with him, or he goes to a place where maybe LeBron was looking at, like Philly. Like maybe Philly does a deal and trades for Kawhi and then doesn't need to go after LeBron and uses the cap space somewhere else. Or let's say L.A. trades for L.A. somehow, Kawhi goes to Spurs and says, trade me to L.A. Yeah. L.A. trades like a whole bunch of their pieces to get Kawhi. They don't now need Paul George to get LeBron. Mm. Now they can get LeBron because of Kawhi.
Okay, before we get into the weeds, Marcellus, I want to ask you this. Yes. The feasibility of the Cavs getting knocked out in the first round, you see them coming to L.A.?
I don't see that direct link. I don't think LeBron's saying, okay, I lost here, and with this young core, a lot of role players that were elevated, and Kevin Love, I'm going to go to the Lakers' young core of a lot of players on the rise, but still deemed role players. No one's a superstar or star just yet. Now you're going to take this same formula and move it west. I don't see how it really changes in the immediate future.
But what about what Brian just said? Kawhi?